again, not every state offers that option. So if you live in a state that's got kind of tough, tight politics, you're kind of out of luck unless you run for office and change things. But here at the citizen level, you can make monumental change to state law. In case of Arizona, not only do we have a recreational initiative that's on the ballot, but 10 years ago, initiative is how Arizona got its medical marijuana program. And it's been chugging along quite successfully ever since. So let's turn now to the Oregon initiative. Now that I've laid that foundation, I hope you understand better what initiatives are and where they come from. So looking to the initiative starts off with a section of findings. And the purpose of those findings, again, is to replace what would have taken place in the legislature, public debates, evidence taking, record making, etc. So this lays that premise down. And as you can see, it talks about budgeting, prevalence of mental illness in Oregon, says that 1 in 5 adults in Oregon is coping with a mental health condition, which, by the way, if I can just pause and sidebar, that's not unique to Oregon. Mental illness in the United States is at epidemic proportion, and it is not being taken seriously near enough. And this is part of why psychedelics are having a resurgence, because people have come to realize that psychedelics are incredibly, incredibly effective at treating a lot of these maladies of anxiety and trauma and stress and depression. So this is Oregon's population openly, as an act of legislative popular rebellion, saying that they want this human condition addressed. Anyway, the findings go on to talk about how even the Food and Drug Administration has given recent favorable review of psychedelics and their efficacy in treating these sorts of maladies. And so what Oregon has decided is to engage in, it says so right here, in a 2-year development of a suitable program that will enable Oregonians to engage in psychedelics. And that leads, of course, to the next section, which is purposes of the act. And you'll see that it talks about formation of a strategic plan and formation of a regulatory framework regarding psychedelics and the services that can be provided in conjunction with them under state law, as well as establishing who is an appropriate person, being someone over the age of 21, and otherwise qualified to participate in psychedelics, or specifically psilocybin program. Key to this initiative is the definition section, section 5. And this is going to lock in for the life of the program, as are all the statutes, who can participate, what participation means, what forms of entities can be involved, etc. Section 6 creates an advisory board so that there will be persons of appropriate qualification in a board comprised of 14 to 16 members appointed by the governor in order to oversee this program. So this assures that there will be a variety of voices engaged in appropriate oversight. All right, Section 10 here talks about the fact that for the 2 years following passage of this initiative, the authority will not be able to issue any licenses under the program. So what this means is for the next 2 years, assuming this passes, no one will actively be participating in anything regarding a psilocybin program in Oregon. Instead, they will be working on creating the rules necessary to run the program. And that bears also another sidebar. So in this instance, what Oregon, if they vote for this, will be doing is vesting the Oregon Health Authority with oversight of the psilocybin program, meaning that there will be an administrative agency that will have administrative authority, which means that agency is going to need to create a host of rules to explain how people go about fulfilling the rights and obligations of the statutes, because the statutes themselves do not fully flesh out the program. No body of statutes ever does when we're talking about administrative agencies. So this two-year period, which, by the way, will go by very quickly when we're talking about creating rules, this two-year period will be used in order to start drafting those rules, have public debates over them, allow for public comment. There will be public forums held, plural, where people can come from the community and speak for or against pretty much anything they want related to the rules. There will be groups that will submit rules, and there will be competing rules, and that takes a while to ferret through. So 2 years is not unreasonable, considering also that Oregon is creating something from nothing. There's never been a psilocybin program in the United States before, let alone one like this. So that said, let's keep digging in. Okay, so Section 15 talks about licensure. And there's a lot of instances here of times where people don't qualify for licensure. And the big one here you want to know is that the program is basically going to be open to people over the age of 21. So this tells you out of the gate that Oregon's answer to the what about the kids question is addressed right here up front in the statute. Nobody under 21. It's going to be an adults-only program. All right, the next is Section 23, which talks about manufacturer licenses. So if you're desirous of being a mycocultivator, this is the section you would be most interested in. Also, if you want to be a party who perhaps processes the mushrooms after they're harvested, like make them into candies or chocolates, this might be also your section. All right, now Section 26 is where Oregon's initiative gets very interesting and brings us full circle to where I started talking today in this episode about my conversation with my friend and how my friend's friend had a bad episode. So Oregon's answer to the question of where, because we already know who, it's going to be adults over 21. Oregon's answer to where is that Oregon intends to license psilocybin service centers. And as you read through the statute, it does not mean necessarily that this is going to be a full-blown hospital or a medical facility. I don't get that impression whatsoever from reading the statute. But it's got all the typical zoning requirements. They don't want this near schools or churches, which, by the way, in my cannabis law practice is absolutely the norm. We see those sort of zoning restrictions in the cannabis world as well. And in fact, the statutes are so specific on this that there's even separate sections. So there's Section 27 that talks about proximity specifically to a school. Section 28 answers the what happens if a school moves in after you open, which, by the way, that might sound like an unlikely event or super rare, but in the time of people vying for locations that are appropriately zoned, it is not at all uncommon to have competitors open some sort of zoning wrecking business within the envelope of your intended window just to mess with your ability to achieve zoning compliance. We've seen that happen here in Arizona during the opening of our marijuana dispensaries. So then the next section worth peeking at is Section 33 and the ones that follow that discuss psilocybin services, meaning what exactly is the business of these psilocybin service centers. And what we find as we read further here in Section 34, and I've got to scroll to the next page, is that it's kind of a three-step process if you want to be a participant. So this is one of the few ones I'll focus in on particularly. So the first provision says, before a client participates in an administration session, meaning a session where you actually consume psilocybin, you have to attend a preparation session first with a psilocybin service facilitator. Now, this statute does not make the psilocybin service facilitator necessarily somebody with a substantial educational credential or license. For example, it doesn't necessarily have to be a literally or a literal licensed psychologist or psychiatrist. There are a variety of different potential qualifications that will be ferreted out as Oregon makes its rules. Number two is interesting, and I can see a variety of reasons why this is in here, because it says that your preparation session does not necessarily need to be held at the psilocybin service center. So thinking about this from the economics perspective, I would envision that a future psilocybin service center would probably want to hold some semi-occasional group orientation sessions rather than necessarily doing one-on-one preparation sessions. I would imagine just the payroll and the attendant time that gets spent dealing with people one-on-one has got to be really very prohibitive. So the ability to be able to handle groups, I think, will be beneficial. Aside from that, the location of the orientation, I think, similarly respects the fact that you're getting the message. Where you get it really is irrelevant. And likewise, being able to come to a patient who might be incapacitated to the point where they just can't or have trouble coming directly to the service center, it needs to be accommodated for as well. Remember, this isn't a medical program in Oregon that's treating people who have various psychic injuries, and I can readily see that the ability to come to the patient has tremendous value as well. And then there's number three, where the preparation session is then required to be consummated with a signed, certified attestation form, which, analogizing to Arizona's medical marijuana program, we have a system in our statutes and in our regulations that require patients to be reviewed and certified by recommending physicians. This is Oregon's method of dealing with that qualification problem. They are requiring some form of a psilocybin facilitator to certify. Now, here again, this is an interesting thing, because I can readily imagine, and I suspect you can as well, that there are not many physicians, if this program required physicians only, there are not many physicians who would be necessarily willing to assume the professional liability risk of recommending psilocybin to patients. I would imagine there is a reticence for that. So having the ability for the agent who certifies patients to be in a broader category than licensed physicians will help to bring this medicine to the public. And that's worth popping back up to the top real quick. I want to show you the definition for psilocybin service facilitator. It's a pretty broad definition. And here we go. Number 15. Psilocybin service facilitator means an individual that facilitates the provision of psilocybin services in this state. So Oregon is letting the board that will be forming the program decide who that person needs to be. And it's not going to be just one person. There's going to be obviously multiple psilocybin service facilitators. But their qualification may not necessitate that they hold PhDs or MDs. Okay, so now that we're done with the preparation session, the next thing that happens is, if you're qualified to participate, we then jump down to section 36, which is the administration section, administration session. And what the administration session is, well, pretty much what it sounds like. It's where you're going to attend a session and the psilocybin will be administered. The important thing here is number two. It says an administration session must be held at a psilocybin service center. And again, we come full circle to where this episode started. What Oregon has decided for the time being is that rather than have people participate at home alone, unattended, that they will instead have to go to a specific facility that is built out appropriate to the purpose, and they will need to have some form of a facilitator, or trip sitter is probably equal term, present and attendant to help the session. Now, this doesn't mean that the facilitator has to participate the whole time. They just have to be there in attendance if they are needed. So if isolation is needed for a session, that's going to be possible still. But you'll still necessarily have to go to the facility. Now, I realize that's probably a compromise that had to be made in order to make this initiative more palatable. But it does immediately raise the question that what do you do in the instance of a patient who might be so incapacitated that they just literally can't get to the facility? I can envision a lot of different scenarios where somebody couldn't necessarily go, but would still benefit if they could, and perhaps some accommodation needs to be made for them. In any event, Section 37 is the third of three events that takes place in connection with the Psilocybin Service Center. And this is the integration session. Now, for people who have not had any experience with psychedelics, this is going to be a completely new concept. And for those who have had experience with psychedelics, you'll instantly know exactly what this is about. But for those of you who've never had the experience, which I suspect might be a lot of you, when you take a psychedelic, it opens your psyche up. The word psychedelic means mind manifesting. It's a strange effect that it's impossible to describe unless you've had the experience. And that's a tough part of the psychedelic conversation with anybody who's never had the experience, because there's really no metaphor that comes and lends itself to reasonably express what it's like. So in any event, that's what the integration session is for, is that the effects of the psilocybin will have your emotions open, your memories surface, and this can be unsettling for some people, or just confusing, or could be downright wonderful and pleasant. It really just depends on the individual. But sometimes it helps to have a friend or just a person there to talk it out so you can express it out loud and integrate it so that you can perhaps better understand what you experienced or why or what to do with what you have just learned about yourself or where to go next. And Oregon acknowledges that that is a natural byproduct of psychedelics and also natural part of the healing process when dealing with a variety of psychic traumas. So they make it mandatory that the integration session be made available. But because not everybody has trouble integrating or desires to share with another what their experience was, the integration session itself is actually optional to the patient. It's just that they have to be offered the opportunity and provided it if they request it. The other nice thing too inside of this section 37 is number two here, which says that the integration session doesn't necessarily have to be held at the Psilocybin Service Center. That actually tells you two things. Number one, it tells you you don't have to do the integration session the same day you have the administration of the psilocybin. You can have your experience and then go home or somewhere else and wait a few days or weeks and then have your integration session later. And it also tells you that you can do it in any location you choose. So there might perhaps be preference for doing it at home or in a group therapy session or someplace else, convenient to you or your therapist. Anyway, the rest of the initiative delves into kind of the legal structures and reporting requirements and safety requirements that are going to be placed on these facilities. and need not go into any of that. But here we'll stop at section 45, though, because this now addresses the actual mushrooms. We've talked so far about the facilities that will be responsible for administering them and treating the clients. But what about the mushrooms themselves? Well, Oregon has decided to put it in the hands of the Liquor Control Commission, which I'm completely unfamiliar with Oregon's liquor control laws. I'm not licensed in Oregon and don't practice law in Oregon. But if I can analogize to Arizona and make some assumptions, liquor is one of the most heavily regulated things anywhere in any state. So whenever you put anything in the hands of a liquor control board, there's a ton of regulation. And again, these statutes require that additional regulations be created in order to establish this program. And it's a 2-year waiting period before this program officially launches. Okay, Section 57 is a prohibition against purchasing, possessing, or consuming psilocybin products outside of a psilocybin service center. And that answers the final question for today. It's not only the who and the where, but this is the what. So the what is there is no private psilocybin possession or consumption inside of this initiative. So Oregon is not legalizing initiative for the masses or for the public. They are instead creating a psychic palliative program, if you will. My words, not theirs. So Oregon's program is intended to be well-structured, reasonably restricted, adults only. It will have strong controls over who gets to cultivate mushrooms, who gets to even participate in the program. There's no home possession, no home consumption, no home cultivation. And I know some people will say that's a pretty aggressively locked down program, but the reality is this. It's a start. It's a fine beginning to a bright, broader future. And this program, I think, is going to be a bellwether for the nation. And I am very much looking forward to Oregon hopefully passing IP34 and allowing this experiment to take place. And regardless of how it goes, because really ultimately what Oregon, I think, is doing is bringing to the market, ironically, at a time when psilocybin mushrooms will probably be FDA approved, near about the same time, because there's a few psilocybin products right now that are on FDA fast track. So the conventional wisdom is they'll be available to the public through prescription in about 2 years. So what Oregon's program effectively does is create sort of a citizen's version, which in turn makes sure that it's actually more broadly available than what most people believe the FDA is apt to do, and also at a more affordable price than perhaps a prescription psilocybin might be. But that's all speculation at this point. Nobody really knows the numbers, the prices, the availability. None of it has happened yet. So we're all patiently waiting. Anyway, so I'm going to end where I started by going back to my friend's story, that they have a friend who had a sort of troubling mushroom experience, and they did it at home with the wrong set and setting. Oregon is taking a brave first step into giving people like that and many, many other psychically traumatized people an opportunity to experience the wonderful benefits of psilocybin in a safe environment that doesn't require the outrageous infrastructure and expense of a full industrialized medical program. And I look forward to seeing how Oregon progresses, and I wish everybody well. Anyway, I want to thank you again for joining me on another episode of Psychedelica Lex. I do hope you tune in and hope you subscribe. You can also find me on Facebook and also on Twitter and on my Psychedelica Lex page, and you can find me on my Psychedelica Lex website, www.psychedelicalex.com. The book is available now on Amazon. Take care.